Next on stage, I'm very pleased to ask Chris Peters here in the room. No need to introduce him, of course. Everybody in Belgium knows Chris Peters, the CEO of DataMinded, a group of passionate geeks who are working in the field of data engineering. And Chris will share with us what he has learned in data analytics projects.
Indeed. So today, who of you has worked in data analytics and can say that honestly all their projects were 100% success? Like, you never missed a deadline, you never not deliver on client expectations, you did everything as expected. I think there's not a single hand in this audience should go up, right? And it's the same for us. We had our own failures, we had our own lessons learned, and I want to share a few of those lessons learned here. I think maybe an unexpected first lesson learned is that my slides are not on the screen, so you're just going to have to listen to me all the time talking and not seeing any of the slides. wait. Maybe we should be a bit more patient. There they are. Indeed. So success and failure in big data analytics and in giving presentations about it. I think that some screens take a long time to load, and I think there are five ways how you can introduce Murphy into your data analytics project. You don't always want to introduce Murphy. You try to avoid him, but it happens, right? And the first, should we wait for the loading screen, or should we just carry on? All right, so the first way of how to screw up your big data project is screwing up the process. And what do I mean by that is that, to give an example, a couple of years ago, I worked on a huge data analytics project. We had three teams spread over three different continents, and we were literally working 24 hours a day to deliver the project to the client. It was very stressful, very tight deadlines. It was very hard to meet those. But after a year of working like crazy, we finally shipped to the client. We were very proud. We showed it to the client, and the client said, well, that's not what I need. He threw our entire solution away, and he replaced it by three Excel files. It's really embarrassing. It's one of the low lives of my career. It's why have I worked for a year when we could have solved it with three Excel files? I felt like we missed the point completely. I felt like our success was measured by the output, like our velocity, our story points, the number of features we delivered, the numbers of bugs we fixed. All of that didn't matter, because the only thing that really mattered was the outcome. And the outcome was, what was the impact for the client of our project? And well, it turned out to be zero. So what can you do about that? It's to be truly lean. And I don't mean have a Scrum project where you first take 3 months to design a solution, then 3 months to architect the solution, then you do 6 months of development, but hey, you're agile, right? So you, there we go. this is what I mean, where you first design a solution and then you're agile. So you do the development in short cycles of 2 weeks, and then you move on to an integration. You try to just shove it to QA, and QA, out of desperation, passes it on to IT operations, which there it usually crashes and burns. This is not agile. You might be agile in the middle, but you're still doing a waterfall project. It still takes 12 months to ship something to a client. It's a failure. So what can you do to prevent this? As I said, be truly lean and mean, and that means go through the cycle as fast as you can. It's a cycle of design, develop, test, release. How fast? You should be able to do this 10 times a day. If you ship to your client 10 times a day, you will learn from your client 10 times a day. If you ship to your client once a year, and I've learned this from experience, you will learn from your client once a year. It's very painful, trust me. So next up is technology. So we run a data analytics company, and very often clients come to me and say, Chris, I've heard so much about big data. I want to do big data. I think big data is the future. What can we do with big data? And my advice to them is always the following, if it loads. It's really embarrassing, actually. let's go to the next slide. I always tell them to just go away. I think having big data envy is one of the biggest problems in the industry today. It's what Dan O'Reilly said, is that big data is like teenage sex. So everybody talks about it. Nobody really knows how to do it, but everybody thinks everybody else is doing it, so everybody claims they're doing it. most big data problems you can turn into a small data problem and still get 80% of the value. If that is true, you should do that first. And once you delivered your small data project, then you move forward to big data, not the other way around. Next mistake you can make is believing the demo. A typical demo goes like this. You are losing money. Your company is so stupid. You are using old technology. You are very, very way behind the curve. But we have a magical solution that looks like this. It prints out Hello World on the screen. I can code it in 15 minutes. Hello World in big data, by the way, is word count or streaming word count. And after that, hallelujah, you're saved. Your business will get more revenue. You will get a promotion from your boss, and your team will high-five you every time you come into the office. So let me tell you, no big data project is as simple as 15 minutes, so don't believe the demos. You can get some inspiration from it, but don't believe them. The answer, of course, is to see another loading screen and to treat your technology as tools. So don't have a fetish over technologies. Have a fetish over your customer problems and use the technologies that you have available as tools to solve your client problems, not the other way around. Third on the list is architecture. I think this is a bit more subtle point, but making stuff generic is usually a dangerous approach. If you don't know what I mean, is that if a client comes to you and says, I want A, then what you actually heard was, he wants a generic system to deliver all the letters of the alphabet, and probably also Chinese letters and Japanese letters and Russian letters. So you spent months delivering that system, and you find out once you ship that system that actually he didn't want all the other letters, he wanted numbers, or you wanted that letter on a mobile device, and all of a sudden your system doesn't work anymore because you can't print the Chinese letters on a mobile device or something. So I'm okay with making stuff generic, but only do it after the fact. Once you've implemented three use cases and it kind of becomes obvious what the client really wants, then make a generic system out of it. Don't do it in the first place. This XKCD cartoon, which does load, is relevant, where the guy wants some salt. And he said, what are you waiting? Give me the salt. Yeah, but I'm making a generic condiment passing system. Well, it's been 20 minutes. It's just pass him the salt, right? It doesn't matter if it saves him time in the long run. Just pass him the salt. Finally, worshipping a golden hammer. I think everybody knows what a golden hammer looks like, but I've got an illustration for those who don't. A golden hammer looks like this. It is big, it is expensive, and has an Oracle logo on it or from some other vendor, which is very expensive. And you try to solve all your problems with that golden hammer because, dear God, you just spent $3 million on that golden hammer. So all your solutions will look, all your problems will look like nails, and you will make things very, very complex to fit it all into your golden hammer. Don't do it. Next up is missing out on the cloud. I think the cloud has made things so much easier for us. In our space, if you want to have a dupe on-premise, you can get Cloudera dupe. It has a 407-page manual to install. So a dupe in the cloud, that's one command, and you get Hadoop in the cloud. So it just spins up automatically. So Hadoop has become a commodity. We really treat our clusters like shit. We kill them, we spin them up, we are very random about them. I think if Gaia were to see how we treated our clusters, for sure we would be in the news the next day. But it's super cool. This is possible now. It's a solved problem. You don't need to do that on-premise anymore. So my advice for architecture, keep calm and simplify. Don't make it overly generic. Don't try to invent very complex things. Just make the simplest possible architecture to deliver your client needs. Next up is teams. So a lot of companies think, are we going to do a data science project? So what do we need? We need data scientists, right? The thing they forget is that 80% of the work of a data scientist is actually collecting the data, preparing the data, cleansing the data. You need a lot more than just data scientists. You need data engineers, you need DevOps specialists, you need distributed systems architects, you need front-end developers, you need a lot of different things besides data scientists. Similar is that you hire a bunch of juniors without having seniors to support them. And I get it, juniors are a lot of fun in the office, right? They are very dynamic, they're very energetic, they get a lot of work done. But if you don't have the seniors to guide them in the right direction, that can be like the most expensive mistake you'll make. So in terms of teams, my tip, my advice is diversify. Have a cross-functional team. Make sure they differ in terms of experience, in terms of skill level, in terms of whatever you can find. It's a lot more valuable than having this narrow specialist team. Finally, and that's another big one, I think there's a lot of books written about leadership. I'm not going to talk too much about it, but I think one thing that annoys me so much is leaders not owning their mistakes. So failures inevitably do happen, and I have a failure of my own that I want to share, is that A while ago, I was responsible for a big data platform at a client, and so that should be something I would be able to do, right? And we interviewed some of the engineers, like, after a couple of months, how happy are you with the big data platform we're building? And the results were negative, and not slightly negative, they were embarrassingly negative. It was very painful. And at that point, I could start blaming other people, say, yeah, but leadership didn't give me the right direction, or this, or QA, or whatever. But then nothing would have changed. So the right thing to do there is to swallow up your pride, go to the developers and say, why do we suck? How can we suck less? Those are the two questions you need to ask. Don't try to blame anybody else. There's a great quote related to the to this from this scary guy over there. And he says, you must own everything in your world. There is no one else to blame. It's from Jocko Willink. Even though if you didn't cause it, it doesn't matter. It's you who have to solve it. And I just wish leaders would embrace that a bit more. Do a post-mortem. If a project dies, look at why it died, look at the clues, and try to understand how can we make the next project not die. Even better, do a pre-mortem. We just started a new project at a client, and the first week we interviewed all business stakeholders and we asked them, so what do you think are the main risks? Why will we fail 6 months from now? And they came with very, very insightful facts about the company and the data and the analytics that we wanted to do. And it's you're miles ahead. If the first line of code you're writing, you already know what the risks are, right? So I can definitely recommend that. So to summarize, let me be very positive about this. So I think there are five ways how you can kick out Murphy out of your project. One is to be lean and mean. Two is treat technologies as tools. Three is simplify your architecture. Four is diversify your team. And five is own your own mistakes. If you do that well, Murphy will magically disappear. The sun will start shining and everybody will be happy. Thank you very much.